Coming to the northern region is not easy.
We need a coordinated, comprehensive development program for the three northern regions that will allow us to bridge this gap.
No northerner wants a handout.
So what needs to be done is clear. We all know that.
The slightest hand that they raise, if at all, they so distinguish. But when I pose these questions, Shakespeare tells me, some are born great and some achieve it, while some have greatness thrust upon them. Can someone tell me, why must I die far, far, deep down the ocean?
Life, they say, is a struggle. It is a struggle to succeed, a struggle to meet one's aspirations. For residents of the old Fadama slum, however, life is a battle for survival.
We have a population of about 80,000, 79,694, that's close to 80,000. And the majority comes from the northern part of the country.
Which part of the country do you come from?
Northern region, particularly Tamale.
Can you tell me a little more about yourself?
Well, I was a student, but I'm from SS2 liver due to financial problem. I couldn't get enough money to proceed, so I decided to quit for some time. If I get money, I could go back and continue.
I came here because of the general hardship in the north. You know, if there was a better place anywhere in the north, I would have moved there rather than instead of coming down all this way to Accra. Yeah.
The old Fadama slum is also called Sodom and Gomorrah. It is a well-known den of crime and other antisocial and immoral activities, similar to life in the doomed biblical city of Sodom and Gomorrah. The Blacksmith Institute of New York named the area the most toxic place on earth. This is where electronic waste is burnt in large quantities.
More than 80% of the population come from the northern Ghana. Very few come from Volta region, and even those that come from Volta region, they are also from the northern part of Volta region, around Nkwanta area. You know, we are almost like the same northerners.
Most of them are scrap dealers, and for the women, a lot of them are these head porters, and the rest artisans of various kinds. dressmakers, hairdressers, mechanics, and what have you.
The slum is also a source of hope for people who have dreams but cannot support these dreams anywhere else in the country. Abdallah came to the slum from the northern region 9 years ago. He had completed the junior high school and had no support to continue his education. The money he has earned from doing menial jobs in the slum has paid for his education. He's now in the university.
I'm in level 300 business administration.
The men here are mainly scrap metal dealers. They travel up to 20 kilometers daily to scavenge for scrap metals. The women and girls, some as young as 10 years, are head porters. They ply their trade at Ghana's biggest foodstuff market, the Agboboloshe market.
There are days you go and you will not get anything. You push the truck around and finally you come home reckless. You'll be very tired.
Sometimes, you know, they are misinformed about the situation in Accra here. So they rush down only to be disappointed that it is not as they thought. But when they come and they face the reality, they just take up the challenge and work hard. Everybody in this community is hardworking. So they just work hard. Accommodation is always a problem, a serious problem, especially for the porters. We have a lot of them sleeping in a room, which is not the best. But they have no choice. They live in this condition. Another challenge is sanitation. When it rains, there is no drainage system in the community, so the whole environment is almost flooded, some of the rooms leaking, and even water coming from inside the rooms. But they still have to live in this condition and work as well.
Former British Prime Minister Tony Blair once described Africa as a scar on the conscience of the world. If there is any settlement that can be described as the scar on the conscience of Ghana, then it is the Sodom and Gomorrah slum.
We necessarily must do something about it because it is a danger both to the people who live in the settlement and to the whole of the development of the city. There was a plan to resettle the people at Ajin Kotoku, and that project was not ever completed, and so the resettlement didn't take place. But I think that we must learn the lessons of what has happened, and out of this tragedy, one has to do what he has to do. And so I guess, I mean, Sodom and Gomorrah is an indictment on us. Even the conditions in that settlement are not the best for human habitation.
In June 2015, heavy flooding in the city of Accra caused the death of more than 150 people. Many of the deaths were recorded when fuel from a leaked fuel station mixed with flood waters and caught fire. To prevent future flooding in the city, parts of the Sodom and Gomorrah slum was demolished to make way for the construction of a storm drain.
The only demolition that will happen tomorrow is the demolition from the flood area to the backyard of Adedeko, where I grew up and I know the boundaries of the toilet. That one, we will do that tomorrow.
It's an unfortunate situation because we are all human beings, you see. I learned that they say they have some 100 meters to demolish. Now, it's like they are going on beyond that 100 meters. So that's what annoying those people.
Right now, you come and destroy us. Eh? Where can I go? Come on, banana roll, lorry fare. You know the lorry fare. The lorry fare, 1.5. Last month, 500,000, 540. Right now, yesterday starting here, everybody go house, 1.5. Document station, 1 million. Why?
You are foreigners.
Here the tamale, 1.5. Why? If you want to scatter here, bring the gas. Everybody enter, go free.
Those of you who have agreed to go to the north, there are buses here. There should be no agitation. There should be no confusion. Please get on the buses and go peacefully. Please. There should be no problem. Today is sanitation day. Today is sanitation day. Like all communities in Accra, I hope that the elders and the people of the people of Fadama have also done the cleaning.
The situation is very, very bad. Since yesterday, people have been here stranded. Some of them don't even have money to travel back to the north. So we are appealing to the government, the MPs, to come to their aid. Some of them have lost almost everything.
Sing. Homeless, homeless. Moonlight sleeping on a midnight lake. Homeless, homeless. The moonlight sleeping on a midnight lake.
And we are homeless.
We are homeless. The moonlight sleeping on a midnight lake.
And we are
homeless.
Homeless.
We are homeless.
Boom, boom.
The moonlight sleeping on a midnight lake. See you, yeah. See you, yeah.
Men, women and children who were displaced by the demolition went back to where they came from, northern Ghana. It is often said that the best way to starve a river is to block its source. Policymakers and politicians have often maintained that the surest way of curbing the influx of jobless youth from the north to the south is to provide job opportunities in the north.
Now, according to the 2000 population and housing census and subsequent upgrade reports, the three northern regions remain the poorest in the country. What are your plans to address this unacceptable situation? And I'm starting with you, Professor Mills.
Well, thank you. I won't go in for any fanciful ideas. I will do what is practical. What have we done to the three northern regions? First of all, when it comes to manpower development, we do have a rule which has been existing for some time that we are to, school feeding is free in these schools. But sometimes the schools are closed down for a very long time because the grants are not coming. I'll make sure I give them the grants.
I keep saying that no northerner wants a handout. I'm a proud northerner. I had equal access, and I'm just like any other Ghanaian. That's all Ghanaians in the north are asking for, equal access to what the nation has to offer.
There is a gap between the development of the south and the north. Whose fault it is, finger pointing, is not going to help us. It is a reality of our life. How do we address it? In our view, piecemeal measures will not do. Tinkering here will not do. We need a coordinated, comprehensive development program for the three northern regions that would allow us to bridge this gap.
Everybody in Ghana knows what needs to be done. I have traveled from Watubauga. 2 weeks ago, it took me 7.5 hours. I could have been to London. Just yesterday, from Pandai, coming to Wulensi, to Bimbila, you know, it is terrible. The water is terrible. So what needs to be done is clear. We all know that. The people need jobs. We all know that. But all I want is taking the people in this Ghana What I want to stick in your heads is that the people in the North need peace, and we need leadership that will work to bring the peace, and I will be the peacemaker.
I disagree completely with the fact that the North is poor. I always argue from a perspective that the North has not been enabled to realize its economic potential. That I can say for sure, and I can give a lot of evidences why, and maybe the way forward. I have some new ideas, but I don't subscribe to the view that the North is poor. No.
So why do you say that?
Let's just move a few kilometers out of Ghana, and we're in Burkina. And that is even more resource limiting than Northern Ghana. And they are not poor. At least even if they are poor, they are currently feeding Ghana in terms of livestock, meat, tomatoes, all sorts of vegetables, and even fruits and so on and so forth. So I simply say that if you're able to create those same enabling environment opportunities here in the North, we might even do better than Burkina. And it's these enabling environments that are found lacking.
The most challenging issue, the one that everybody, I guess, would understand, is that the South has got two rainy seasons, the North has got one. That is only an issue, a major challenge, because we haven't done so well with irrigation, capturing the water, storing it, and using it efficiently. But that is linked to the second problem, the second major challenge. There's a lot more economic activity in the South than there is here. Economic activity as in people doing work and getting paid good money for the work that they are doing. There's a lot of people who are working and working hard here, but they are deriving very, very low value from the work that they are doing. That is the contrast. You work hard in the South, you get some produce, you have good markets. Even though down South, we also complain that the markets are not so good. But guess what? Compare what is available in the South to what is available up North here, and the difference is as clear as night can be distinguished from day.
This one, if you are a fan, we put our food there.
Your food here, so this is like a barn. Okay, so what kind of crops do you put here?
Minerals. Millet.
Millet, okay.
Yes.
Okay. Do you have some here now?
Yes.
Oh no, but there's no food inside now. Yeah, you've eaten everything. What about this one?
For this year, we found didn't get any food.
You didn't get much food this year.
No.
So your food is finished. So how are you going to survive till the next farming season?
Oh, if God bless us, we'll get some food to eat. Even now, because there's no food, we are fine, but we didn't get it.
Normally, the youth from families such as this would have to go to the cities to work for the upkeep of their kith and kin here. The few who have access to water engage in dry season irrigation farming, like these farms near Navrongo.
If they say I'm to pluck it this week, and I drink gets the sellers, the other week, the red ones all rot, which means I can't get them again. And the second one, if it is still going the same way, which means all will rot and I cannot get anything. So the major problems for the farmers is this thing, the marketing side.
You go to a market where someone will be willing to pay you good value for it. Those kinds of markets don't exist up here in the North. If they do, they are not that many. And we know some of the reasons why. Challenges with regard to infrastructure. To the extent that even if I know that there is a market in Tamale, it will pay me a good price for my goat, or my cow, or my guinea fowl, or my millet, or sorghum, whatever I have. Getting that guinea fowl, getting that sorghum from my village to the good market in Accra, or to the good market in Tamale, that's where the constraint is. Here, people won't go to the farm gates because they just can't go to the farm gates. You are aware of the situation in parts of the North that are called overseas. When it rains, everybody is cut off.
Hey!
my driver. That's my car line there. It is the balance, the road. How they have diverted this thing. It's too long. And yesterday it was raining. So I came and reached here and then it slipped.
We have to open up the country. Coming to the northern region is not easy. I will make sure that effort is made. We get a separate authority which is going to look at the development of the northern regions. They have enough potential already. It's only a question of harnessing the potential that they have and concentrating on making the things work.
This is the dawn of a new era of change for a better Ghana.
Professor John Evans Atamels won the 2008 elections. True to his promise, he set up the Savannah Accelerated Development Authority, SADA.
Interestingly, I've been part of the history of SADA. I remember four key people. There were some others. But key amongst us was Sule Garba, Dr. Jebuni, Professor Dito, and myself. And we were looking back at Northern Ghana and some of the things that can help us grow Northern Ghana. In doing so, we brought to bear our experiences. The initial perception we had for NOREP was a project that would serve more as coordinating and facilitation.
SADA,
yes. Coordinate, facilitate, provide the enabling resources and the environment I talked about, and ask for accountability from duty bearers. Because we tried implementation in URADEP, we have our experiences. NOREP, we know what happened. We say for once, let's look at a project that will be couched differently.
SADA was set up as a regional development agency. The expectation was that SADA would understand the constraints, would even go further than what I have alluded to, do a much more detailed analysis of these constraints. Because some of the things I've pointed out are causes, and some are symptoms. Okay? What SADA was expected to do was to delve deeper and find out what are the causes.
The previous administration before the NDC, that is the MPP administration, was the first to come out with a very bold decision about the Northern Development Fund, which they intended to use to be able to bridge the gap between the North and the South. And then when the NDC administration took over, they decided to upscale it to cover a wider area and then larger amount of money, all for the same purpose of bridging the developmental gap between the North and the South.
The budgetary allocation to SADA was 25 million cedis in 2011 and 20 million cedis in 2012, together making about $22 million. The government also issued a bond of 200 million Ghana cedis or $100 million in 2012. This was to serve as the seed capital for SADA.
From other development partners, for instance, the same DFID gave us $80 million to start what we call the Millennium Village project.
After 2 years of its operations, I set out to investigate how the resources SADA had mobilized from government and donor agencies were being put to use. I started my journey from the Northern Volta. The SADA zone begins here. The signs of poverty are very visible as one enters the SADA zone. At Dambai, treated drinking water is a luxury, even though the Oti River flows through this town. In the Krach West district, children have to break from school in their uniforms to struggle for water when the few reliable taps begin to flow. Here, the Volta Lake flows through this town, but potable drinking water is a scarce commodity. In one part of the town, this is how they get water. One of Sada's early projects is the mango project, which was undertaken in partnership with some private plantation keepers known as service providers. The service provider for the Volta region is Richard Plantations Limited. The nursery site is less than 100 meters away from the Volta Lake, and the seedlings held a lot of promise for the Sada Mango project. But this was not a story on the field where the seedlings were transplanted. At Kadentre in the Crouch West district, 15 acres of land was put under mango cultivation. But about 80% of the plants were withering or had withered when I visited.
We planted as late as October, and so they didn't have the benefit of enough rains. So you can see that most of the plants, like where we are, it's not looking too good.
From the plantation, I went to meet the farmers who had come together to embark on the project.
We decided
At Ntewusai, also in the Crouch West district, 85-year-old Alex Jinji planted very early and was able to keep most of his crops alive. But some of his mangoes were withering because there was no water. Madam Mary went into this project with a lot of hope. Her main worry was the lack of water to literally nourish her hopes. She also complained that Sada owed her money.
They said the tractor will come and plow. But I waited for the tractor. It couldn't come. So I went to Brother Pa, and he told me they have some boys who will cut the land for me, and they will collect 1.5. So I don't have that money. So later they came and gave deaf and dumb people, and they gave them some money. My child too is deaf and dumb. So when they gave her, I asked her to give me. They said, if you get the money and farm, they will come and pay it back to you. So I told her, and she gave the money to me. But I waited, money no comes.
The situation got worse as I traveled deeper into the Sada region. Sada had failed to mechanize the boreholes that would provide water to support the plantations, as had been agreed. Alhaji Sumala planted 20 acres of mango. His efforts have been wasted because the borehole drilled in his farm was not mechanized.
So I'm not happy. I was not happy. Because I would suffer, would clear the land, would make so many work here, thinking that by now this mango has grown, so that also by 2 years or 1 year time, we're also happy. But up to now, but it's a problem to us.
Ibrahim Idrisu also planted 20 acres of mango. He was not even lucky to get a borehole, let alone ask for mechanization.
There's nothing like this now, sir. Before I even get the water, this is what is giving us problem. We were thinking we can overcome this work very well, so that our suffering will not be useless. Taking care of 20 acres as five or six of us, you know, it's not a small. So we have to stop everything and started doing the work. Later on, came to have it lost. Excuse me, because we didn't survive. Rain stopped, no water. When we have already transplanted in my farm over 1,000 mango seedlings, and they are all there dying.
Sada cleared the land and provided farmers with the seedlings. Sada was also supposed to drill and mechanize boreholes to water the plantations. The farmers were to provide labor and pay back Sada's investment after harvesting the mangoes. Sada, however, failed to mechanize the boreholes, thereby crippling the project.
There's no water to survive them. So we are all at loss, we and Sada people together.
In the Upper West region, the mango project faced even more crippling challenges. Matsko Plantation was the service provider contracted by Sada to implement the project in this region. At this farm, 50 acres of mango was cultivated. The chief executive officer of the plantation told me the survival rate in his region would not be more than 10% by the time the rains set in.
We have a total of 660 acres cleared and 630 acres planted. I've been given 50 boreholes.
50?
50. So far, not one of them has been mechanized yet.
Former CEO of SADA, Gilbert Sedu Idi, says in all, 120 boreholes were drilled. Each one cost 25,000 cedis, or $12,500, making a total of 3 million cedis, or $1,500,000. Clearing the land, supplying of fertilizer and other inputs, as well as labor expenses, put the cost of this project into several millions of dollars. But SADA's failure to mechanize the boreholes has negated the viability of the project.
The boreholes were supposed to have been mechanized before the planting.
No, not before planting. Before the end of the rainy season.
Before the end of the rainy season.
Yeah.
And the rainy season ended around
September, October.
September, October.
Yeah.
And then that has not been done. And I can tell you the mangoes are dying.
Mm.
Are you aware of this?
No, I wouldn't be.
But you should expect naturally that when you plant the mango seedlings and there's no water to feed them, they will surely die.
Yeah.
So if the boreholes are even mechanized in
today
there will be casualty. There will be casualty.
Yeah, I know.
So have you failed in that regard?
No.
The mango project.
You see, startup activities should not be looked at from that perspective.
No, but
you start with
money,
difficulties and challenges.
Yes, I know
so
that.
So you don't look for an ideal situation when you are starting.
Yes, but We are looking at the level of casualty. The farmers are there, their investments, SADA's contribution, everything is coming to zero.
Mm-hmm.
As far as that project is concerned, how do you feel about it?
Oh, well, as a matter of fact, this first phase is a pilot phase. It's a pilot phase, and then the scaling up will be based on the experiences that we'll get from the pilot phase. So these difficulties are, you know, they are natural things that will happen. Then you try to see how you can address them. But the reason why the mechanization hasn't started, for some of them, I can't explain.
The former SADA boss, however, insists the project has been successful.
One, you have identified the farmer. One, you've identified the sites. Two, you have the borehole. Stamping has been done in that place. You have taught farmers how to plant. So these are successes.
What was the ultimate goal of that project?
No, but that's what I'm saying.
Was it to see the mangoes alive or to the attempt doing it? You've gone through all the processes.
Let me give you an example. For instance, there are others who have gone through these difficulties, and we have learned from their mistakes and tried to improve on it. We're not the first to introduce mango planting.
Indeed, SADA is not the first organization to undertake mango project in the north. There are many success stories of mango plantation in that part of the country. The SADA service provider whose project failed because SADA did not provide water took me to his own private plantation. With a limited budget, he developed an impressive 50-acre mango plantation a few kilometers away from the failed SADA project.
You may not see the results that you are seeing here on the SADA farms because me, as a private person, I do things at the right time and do it at the right way that it should be done. But SADA, sometimes there are delays in providing of money for various activities.
There is no river or water source close to this farm, but that did not stop this plantation from taking off.
We use clay pots, and that closed clay pots, we fill with water and put them by the side of the mangrove plant, and then that considerably reduced irrigation. As you can see, we mechanized it. Initially, we're using a generator to pump the water up into these overhead tanks that you see over there, and then we then drop it by gravity along five lines each of five sand pipes. So we think that we could replicate the same kind of technology with SADA, but unfortunately, we're not the ones in charge. So that's why.
Did you ever make such suggestions to SADA?
Yes, indeed. I brought the former CEO to this place to see what exactly I was talking about. This is what we call the lift and drop system.
Matco, yes. Man you contracted in the
Upper West
region.
Yes.
He said you visited his farm, is
yes,
it true?
Yeah, I did.
It was a success story.
Yes.
So why should SADA fail?
Why should he fail?
He succeeded on his farm. A private man, he didn't have money like SADA.
He's a technical service provider.
No, what I'm saying is that he succeeded. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
He succeeded because he had a source of water.
He was able to mechanize his farm, and then when you go there, it's a beauty to behold. Mm-hmm. And I think you agree with me.
It's true.
Why didn't you give that contract to mechanize the place to him that he applied?
Did you ask me and say we didn't give it to him?
Yes, indeed. He asked me to submit an estimate, which I did. But as you know, shortly after that, he was no longer at the place, so I don't know what he did with it. I gave an estimate of how much it will cost to put this kind of system in place. I did.
No, he doesn't. He's not an expert in that area.
But he's been able to do it so well.
No, but you don't do that. You don't have the certificate. You don't have the licenses. You get the point.
June 2012, SADA awarded an afforestation contract to ACI Construction Limited to plant 5 million trees in the SADA zone. My investigation has revealed that this company is a building and construction firm. It had no record of undertaking any tree planting project. My investigation into the project more than a year after the trees were planted showed a high level of failure. In the three regions I visited, only a few of the locations had some appreciable level of survival. At the Poitenga site in the Upper West region, a small plantation of acacia near a pond was doing well. At Zingu in the Wa municipality, 1.5 hectares of acacia was also thriving. This site is also near a source of water. At Nakori, also in the Wa municipality, the 15 workers who were engaged to do the afforestation project said they worked for 16 months but were paid for only 7 months. They resorted to voluntary service to keep the 8-hectare mahogany plantation alive using water from a nearby pond.
If we get some small work, we went and did and get some small petrol and put on the machine.
So you take other jobs and when you get money, you buy fuel and...
Yes.
The afforestation sites that had high level of survival were close to water and were relatively small. The larger plantations I visited had a lot of the trees withering. At Nkanchina No. 2 site in the northern region, most of the plants were withering.
Sa October no modin duano ba ye no. No won say aduru dry season. Nti nduano bebre awu.
At the site near Kwandai Senior High School, the story was not different. Here, I discovered that equipment that was to be used to care for the plantation was left to rust. This is the SADA afforestation site near Bar Barracks in Tamale. The wooden pegs indicate where trees were planted. A lot of the trees had withered and some were still withering at the time I visited. At a site near Kamina Barracks, also in Tamale, not even a single tree planted here survived at the time of the visit.
This is the SADA afforestation site at Boku Tampielum in the Boku Central Municipality of the Upper East Region. In most of the sites we visited, we realized that there was no source of water. But just behind me is a dam. But all the trees here are dead.
But it's in a kind of quick, cabalin lebe set. Belin lebin Layang lebe say, but Bapumbronce, Lanisani, Cabronce.
On this site near Zebila, the story of Sada's afforestation project was not different. The Upper East Regional Coordinator of the afforestation project, Raymond Agwanto, took me round some Sada afforestation sites near Bolgatanga.
Oh, okay. Which farm is this one?
This is one of the sites in Mekongo. Yeah. Basically, we planted acacia and teak. This is about 3 hectares.
3 hectares?
Yes. We'd have planted more, but because of land issues, they only gave us this site. Yeah.
So how many trees did you plant here?
This place, we planted about 4,500 trees.
4,500? It doesn't look like it's a good story here. What was the problem?
Basically, you could see that it's recently that the animals came in, you know, on top of the seedlings. But We laid the workers off from 1st October, and since then they've not been here. That led to the animals coming in.
At Zingu in the Wa municipality of the Upper West Region, the project coordinators had to struggle to show me where trees were planted. Parts of this plantation had been burnt by bushfire. So, is the Sada Afforestation Project a success story? This is the question I put to the man who managed this project.
We have been around, you see how hot the sun is. If the trees go 1 month, 2 months without water, it's a different story. And as you can see, the whole place is getting brown. When the animals see anything green, they're going to graze on it. So if there's no one to drive away the animals, there's no one to protect fire from getting onto the plantation, there's no one to water, it can be a success story.
You see, the focus was plant trees create employment. So number one is, has employment been created? The youth who will be employed, have they really been employed? Number two, the trees that we say should be planted, have the trees been planted? These are the two focal issues that we will use to be able to determine the achievement or otherwise of the intervention.
Some part of the Sada zone has a thick vegetation cover. The northern region, for instance, houses Ghana's biggest wildlife forest, the Mole National Park. These areas clearly do not need the afforestation project. But I found out that forests were cleared to make way for the afforestation project in some of the locations. At Blema in the northern region, economic trees such as shea had to be felled to make way for the project.
Some say I have been at the end so happy. Now we must be saying, and you found from Prima. And far you should have been Prima. And you're the idea number to me, you know. Yeah, Hannah, so. Oh, God, who are now this idea way to meet you. Now, Hannah, so I'll acquire Benjamin in Tina, with my mind, and so am I, so I ain't quite there.
And how would do a phone now? Shouldn't be away to meet you.
Yeah, but you. Yeah, you.
If you take tree planting, I was the project director for Savannah Resource Management Project, a World Bank project. That was in Tamale. We did everything about tree planting. We realized that there were more problems with tree planting than the natural vegetation. So we went into natural regeneration where you try to manage the natural vegetation in terms of pruning and doing all the cultural practices. Within that, you can now integrate tree planting so that the entire tree population is part of the project. But I'm beginning to see an attempt to clear the natural vegetation and plant trees. And I said, well, it has been done before.
Sada covers 5 regions. Now, when you come out with an activity and some regions are completely left out, that in itself has got its own ramifications.
And let me give you a solution. Mm-hmm. For instance, you say, for let's say Techiman, you have a lot of trees. Bongo is a very a desert area. Its desertification is just taking over that place. So we are taking tree planting to Bongo. But with this same amount of money, instead of undertaking a tree planting project in your area, let's give you something else because you don't need it. Would that not have solved the problem?
That would have complicated it.
I was given a job to execute, and the job was supposed to be from A to Z. I couldn't have left out some.
Oh yes, but you could have told them that you asked me to plant trees. There are already trees here. It doesn't make sense to clear trees and plant trees.
You know something.
In 2012, Sada entered into a joint venture with Asomtabo Cottage Industry, an exchange program to commercialize the production of guinea fowls. A joint venture company was formed, the Sada Asomtabo Guinea Fowl Production and Marketing Company Limited. The joint venture was to employ 1,500 workers and produce 250,000 guinea fowls per year for sale.
We have a special advantage where you can use semi-intensive method by releasing the birds to walk freely and burn off the cholesterol. So if you compare our situation, we have a comparative advantage even to the leading producers of guinea fowl in the international market. And so we think that in order to be able to move forward, we must exploit this comparative advantage that we have as far as guinea fowl production is concerned. And ultimately, we can be the leading producer of guinea fowl for export in the international market. And that is the driving force that motivated SADA to go into it.
So does SADA know the size of the guinea fowl markets? Even in Ghana here, before we talk about export.
In Ghana, the size is huge. Because a study was made about the viability of the project, you know, and the rate of returns was very, very high.
Yes, but we should know, because SADA specifically stated in your proposal that you intend to produce 250,000 guinea fowls a year. What research did you base this figure on?
I'm saying that there was an earlier study about the, you know, the feasibility of the guinea fowl production. And that gave us a figure about its viability. Now, what is happening is
what research is this one?
Oh, that research was conducted by ACI, the partner that we used in the.
Yes, but I just want to know that perhaps that
we're looking at the market size. Yet. Yeah, as a matter of fact, we haven't reached there yet.
I have spent years working in this part of the world. Parts of Ghana. I come from here. I spent a large part of my working life down south, but I do come up here. And guinea fowl has been of special interest to me. As we speak, I don't have a sense of the true size of the guinea fowl market. Is there room for 250,000 guinea fowl birds to be consumed in a year? I don't know. And I can stick my neck out and say, nobody knows, because I've been asking around and I haven't had an answer. Now, without that knowledge, why would you make an investment?
The guinea fowl project was to be implemented in the five SADA regions. This structure in the Upper East region was already in place and had guinea fowls before the joint venture was entered into. In the Upper West region, the farm was built up to this level and abandoned. In the northern region, it was abandoned at this level. The structures in all the southern regions were not completed. The contractors are alleging that they were not paid for the work they had done. The project has stopped and SADA has not been able to retrieve its investment. The reason for the failure of the guinea fowl project is not difficult to find. The joint venture was a murky transaction that lacked transparency. Even though SADA paid 50 million cedis or $7.5 million to the private company, it could not tell whether the company paid its share of 56.4 equity into the joint venture.
You are aware of the amount of money SADA paid into this joint venture?
Yes.
The total being 50 million.
Exactly, I know that one.
But you don't know how much Asuntaba paid?
Asuntaba was to pay 50 million, but they're not to pay
it to
me.
Did they pay the 50 million?
Not to me.
Not to you, I know, not to you. The 50 million SADA paid was not paid to you. It was not paid into your account. It was not paid into SADA account, but you are aware.
You see, what would have happened is that at the board meeting, this question that you are asking can be relevant. At the SADA board meeting, the SADA board could have invited its representative on that company's board of directors to answer this question.
Are you not part of the SADA board? Were you not part of it?
I know, but that question didn't come up.
And nobody in the SADA board tried to find out whether Asuntaba really paid or not.
The board hasn't really sat down to discuss at the time that I was there, you know.
Gilbert Idi was in office for more than 1 year after the joint venture company was established. He personally signed a check to pay SADA's share of the money into the joint venture. Strangely, he paid the money to the private company instead of the joint venture account.
We signed an agreement with ACI. And at that time, the money was paid to ACI so that when the company was formed, then it would pay it into the company's account. You get it?
So why did you not set up the company before paying the money?
That's what I'm saying. The company was set up before the money was paid.
The joint venture company failed to live up to its promise. SADA has not been able to retrieve its investment as directed by the Auditor General's report in 2013. The Auditor General also faulted SADA for not adhering to transparent procurement processes in the award of contracts. Some stakeholders of SADA share this view.
I don't know how the service providers were selected. If anybody has a criteria, they've not made it known.
I realize that even with my background, it will even be difficult because I realized there was a lot of opportunities, but it was given to the big men.
Those who win, you select them on merit. They must have the capacity to do it. We don't just give it to a few individuals who are already known in the system. We must open it up and get the right people to do the job. That's what I'm saying. Because as I'm sitting there, if you ask me what's the criteria of getting a service provider, I don't know. Who are the service providers? Even if you ask me, I'll be embarrassed.
If you really want to go into tree planting or managing vegetation, and you don't actively integrate the Minister of Lands and Forestry or the Forest Commission, you have problems.
If you say that Forestry Commission collect this money, go and plant trees in the SADA zone, the tendency is that at the national level, Northern Region, Upper East Region, Upper West Region, SADA is already taking care of you. So the budgetary allocation that is meant for Forestry Commission will now be diverted and used in some other regions. So because of that, the advice...
Are you saying this on authority? Did you consult them and this is what they said?
No.
Gilbert Idi would not admit any wrongdoing or failure on the part of SADA. He defended the decision to do sole sourcing in awarding contracts instead of open competitive bidding. The 2013 Auditor General's report said SADA breached the procurement law by handpicking ACI Construction for the afforestation project. The report says the money should be surcharged to Gilbert Idi or ACI Construction. Before I ended my interview with Gilbert Idi, I asked him if he would do anything differently if he had the opportunity to head SADA again.
Yeah, there are certain things I'll do differently.
What are some things?
Like I'm telling you, the whole process of choosing a technical service provider and using sole sourcing, you know, I'll frown on it. That's number one. Then, which other one comes up immediately? Yeah, as far as the tree planting process is concerned, that is the biggest problem. Everything about the tree planting process is all right, except that people have questions about the person you have chosen. Not because you have chosen him, but there are question marks about him which you didn't know and which you didn't factor in at the time you were taking that decision.
Indeed, there are question marks about the person SADA handpicked for the projects. The SADA afforestation project was awarded to a company owned by Roland Agambiri. The guinea fowl project was also awarded to a company owned by the same person.
When I got into Silvo Middle School Form 1, that was a time there were so many crises in terms of fuel. People couldn't get fuel across to the Burkina border. The price of fuel in Ghana was lower than that in Burkina. Even as we speak today, we still have said problem. And I found out that the women in the village, they had the money, but they couldn't travel. We are afraid to travel to the nearby towns as Bolga, Upper East Region.
So you took the risk again?
I took the risk. I massaged all of them. They come together, 10 women, they contribute, and they give me all their money, and I'll go to Navrongo, go and rent a vehicle, buy a barrel of fuel, and then put it in the car and bring it to Cerebro and share it amongst them.
My earlier investigation into a corruption scandal at the youth employment program revealed that 4 companies belonging to Mr. Agambiri were involved in that scandal. Sources close to SADA have revealed that Roland Agambiri's company had the upper hand in SADA's contracts because of his connection with President John Mahama. President Mahama has attended many functions organized by Roland Agambiri's businesses and openly endorsed his businesses. When President Mahama organized the only National Youth Achievers Award in Ghana, a month to the 2012 elections, it was sponsored by Roland Agambiri's company. When President Mahama won the 2012 elections, Roland Agambiri's company sponsored many of his congratulatory billboards.
I remember in class one, I started looking forward to be a leader by asking the school SP. I had to look for the school SP just to get him some few granite paste locally at the time, just to get him, make me the team prophet.
Wow.
I mean, class one.
So what was that? Was that well, that is lobby anyway.
That was lobby.
We don't say that is bribery.
No. It was pure lobbying, just to have access to control my colleagues.
In 2012, President Mahama commissioned a guinea fowl farm belonging to Roland Agambire in Bolga in the Upper East Region. At that event, the president hinted that SADA would be encouraged to partner with the company to expand the project. My investigation revealed that this company was paid 1.7 million cedis or $800,000 to train youth in guinea fowl rearing. The company did not train the youth, neither did it return the money to the state. This same company failed to deliver when SADA paid 15 million cedis or $7.5 million to undertake the guinea fowl project. That money too has not been retrieved almost 2 years since the program was abandoned. For some, the money spent on the failed projects could have been used in a better way.
Even if they spend the whole of SADA money and just give us water, more dams here, we'll be able to do all those other things that they are asking for in terms of afforestation.
The Auditor General also indicted SADA management for wasteful and expensive trips to Europe, huge payments to consultants, and investing in projects with very little or no prospects of recouping its investment. There was no actual work beyond the billboards advertising them, like this one near Yape in the northern region. We discovered the equipment procured for the project were abandoned, even though it was the time of the year to do the project. SADA had invested more than $1 million in this project.
How many people eat butternut squash? Do they even know what it is? They know granuts. Deal with granuts. They know millet. They know sorghum. So that if somebody else will say, I won't buy it, they will eat it. If somebody else says, oh, I'll buy it for 10 cedis, you say, no, I don't like your price, we'll eat it. You see? But if you go picking things just to address an imaginary market, when this one is sitting right from you, I think you are looking too far to see God.
More than a year after the Auditor General published the report indicting officials of SADA and businesses, no one has been prosecuted and no money has been refunded.
I can agree with you that, yes, some seedlings have died. Even if all the seedlings died, you don't call it a failure because it's not just an issue of seedlings. Next year, if the water is provided at that site and if it is mechanized, all you need to do is plant seedlings.
And you have funding for that?
For replacing the seedlings. That's what I'm saying, that now that you are making this an issue, if I were in SADA, I probably would search out the contractor who was supposed to provide that one to bear the cost.
And you were in SADA up to November, and by November he was supposed to have mechanized, and he didn't do it. So did you surcharge him?
I haven't reached that stage.
Attempts are being made to rebrand SADA. It is not clear what the future will look like. But one thing is clear. The authority that was set up to give hope to the people of northern Ghana was hijacked by government officials and businesses connected with the government.
By last two months, I didn't have any hope. I was like, SADA is gone. It's just one of the political money machines that we've seen in Ghana before. When they reconstituted the board, I'm beginning to build some hopes again. I'm just waiting. I'm waiting to see how it will go.
Millions of dollars were misused and no one has been held accountable. The economic rain of SADA has fallen heavily, but the ground it was supposed to nurture is still dry. That is the story of the Sad Sada saga.
Maybe Kuala Wabashe Paradiso.